I'm Steve the Bookman Eisenstein in Miami Beach.
I'm Thorne Donnelley from Liberty Bookstore in West Palm Beach, Florida, soon to be from Palm Beach Gardens, Florida.
I'm Lynn Thompson with Henry Bemis Books in Charlotte.
And this is the Rare Book Cafe, the world's only internet video program about antiquarian books and collecting, sponsored by the Florida Antiquarian Book Fair. 36 years, come April 21st and 23rd. We hope you'll all join us at the Coliseum in St. Petersburg. Today's program features LA book dealer John Howell. John is going to be talking to us about the 50th annual California Antiquarian Book Fair. He's going to be talking to us about things that he will be bringing to the book fair. And he will be talking more with Lindsay Thompson, one of my co-hosts, about that bill in California that nobody wants to see in California. How did that book go, Live and Die in California? We hope it lived there and died there. John, welcome to the show.
Thank you.
How are you doing? What's going on? Tell us about the days, the dates, and the things about the California Antiquarian Book Fair in its 50th year.
Well, we actually have two book fairs coming up in California in February. The first one is the Pasadena Antiquarian Book, Print, Photo, and Paper Fair. That will be Saturday and Sunday, February 4th and 5th, 2017. And then the weekend after that will be the 50th California International Antiquarian Book Fair. That will be February 10th, 11th, and 12th at the Oakland Marriott City Center in downtown Oakland, California.
And what are you going to be bringing to the fair? You always have these great books, John, so show us some of them.
You want to see some books? Well, I think in the promo, we looked at the Yosemite book, and it looks like to me it's displaying backwards on this media. We have a lot of Yosemite materials. What was that, Lindsay?
We can see it correctly, so you're good.
Oh, okay.
And as a book dealer for library sales, you have to learn how to read upside down and backwards.
Yeah, this is a book on the Pacific State Advertising Bureau. It's a list of all the newspapers by county and by city in California in 1892, I believe it is. Yep, 1892. And I will also be having some ephemeral material on California tourism, and so on and so forth. This is one example. This is, what's the date on that one?
When was that one published?
1892.
Nice, very nice condition for that.
So,
how's condition in California, John, compared to Florida? I've got to ask you that. When you find books, when I moved to Florida, they said you're going to be sorry, you won't find books, and you'll find them in terrible condition. What's the situation in coastal California?
Some folks don't always, especially in coastal areas, don't always take care of their books. And if they get dust on them and there's a marine influence there, they can get mold on the top edges of their books. That's not good. I don't like to see that. Farther inland, it's drier, and you don't run as much of a risk of that. But where I live in LA, we have pretty good marine influences where we live.
Yeah, go ahead, I'm sorry.
I'm finished with that for now.
No, we've seen a lot of broken treasures. I was just curious when you said that book was from the 1890s, I noticed it was in really nice condition. Continue. What other things? Grab horn? Anything?
I'll get to that here shortly. I have one miniature book that I'd like to show the audience. I'm going to have a lot of miniature books. But this one in particular was designed by a man in England whose name is Gordon Murray. And the title of this book is, what is it? This is the title right up here. Fantasy and Dulac. And Gordon Murray has written this book by hand. He's illustrated it in watercolors by hand.
Wow.
And it's a unique copy. So I have two or three of Gordon Murray's miniature books to show at the fairs. So that's this one. I have a lot of other miniature books, and but this is all I'm going to show you today. You're going to have to come to Pasadena and Oakland to see some.
What size on that, Sean?
The size?
Yeah.
Two by one.
It is two and three quarters by 2 3/4 inches, so it's square.
Yeah, I couldn't tell from the camera. Yeah.
Yeah.
And what are they? What are they going for? What's the retail on it?
The price on this is $1,500, because it's a unique production. This is the only one of this. When he first got started, he would do these letterpress. But as he went on, he kind of got tired of the physical making of the books with the printing press. So he started to make unique productions like this that he illustrated, wrote, and bound by hand himself. So that's why the price on this is in that range.
No, so that's definitely a beautiful book, absolutely. And unique is the word when it's hand colored.
Yeah, that's a book. I'm going to be bringing lots of bookseller memoirs. Some of your, let's see, can we see who this is? This is H.P. Krauss and David Randall, two booksellers represented. I'll have others. Here's a signed copy in a beautiful dust jacket of Rosenbach's The Book Hunter's Holiday. So that got some Rosenbach for you to come see.
And do you have any of the vintage ones from the 20s and 30s?
Some of the Rosenbachs, I think, go back to the 20s and 30s. This one is from Leona Rosenberg and Madeline B. Stern. And that doesn't go back as early as what you were just asking about, 1920s. If anyone buys this beautiful copy of this book, I'm going to have to provide them a certificate of authenticity because Rosenberg and Stern have both signed it. So these are just a few of the bookseller memoirs I have. Most of them are going to be 1970s, 80s, and 90s.
What's the attraction of books by booksellers? Is that just a specialty niche, or is there something unique about that other book dealers like to collect?
I got another one that you all have talked about.
He was very funny.
These came from a private collector, and he was active in the 80s and 90s, and so it's dispersing this collection is what holds all of these together. Is that
I would have to answer that as I happen to have John. Almost all the books you have there, and I am both a collector and a dealer. As a dealer, I've learned from Mr. Rosenbach, I've learned from Mr. Randall. I went to Indiana University where my friend who's Joel Silver, who's now the head of the library there. He preceded him there. So to me, they're real people, people to learn from. And some of the mistakes they've made are absolutely hysterical. And I try not to make them. Of course, I will make my own. But I love books like that. So maybe I'll be a customer for years at the fair.
Well, I wish I had about 2 or 3 years of leisure to read through all of them.
Yes, they're great.
When I started, they were my catnip. I just couldn't read enough about Rosenbach and Newton. Why nobody ever mentions Newton anymore? I'm not sure. Out of the two, I found him more interesting in some ways. But one book that I would highly recommend that business reads is Harry Shapiro's This Book Collecting Racket. It was there when you and I were talking the other day off air, and I'm going to talk about it later, about the limited editions club books. It was there that I learned that unique aspect of what you and I, and I'll share it with the audience later, we're talking about with the limited editions club book. Anybody that starts out in the book business has got to read the earlier history of our trade. It just adds a lot to it. Go ahead. John, continue on.
I reckon this book falls in the category of printing history and typography.
Uh-huh.
It's about the late 18th, early 20th century Italian typographer Bodoni. And this is a new book that's come out recently. And what's nice about this copy is that it is signed by the author. Another book that California AB 70 is going to require me to provide a certificate of authenticity for, but I'll have more printing history books with me. But that's that for that subject area, I think. I do like to specialize in the history of the book trade, particularly in Los Angeles. And I have a handwritten note from Sister Mary Dominic, who before she took orders in the Brigantine group in her name before she took her vows was Helen M.D. Redpath. And this is a letter that she wrote to Helen Schaefer when Helen Schaefer was working at Dawson's Bookshop. And this is the letter. And the contents of it have to do with some leaves from the Nuremberg Chronicle that Helen Schaefer sent to Sion Abbey in Marley, South Brent, Devonshire. And Ellen Schaefer, working for the Dawsons, became an expert in incunables and early printed books. And Schaefer wrote a book on the Nuremberg Chronicles. So this is an example of book selling in Los Angeles and scholarly work that booksellers do.
What period is that letter from?
The date is 4th June 1933.
Wow.
So that's getting closer to your time period there, Lindsay. This is an example of a fine printing item from the Ten Fingers Press, and you can see their initials there on the front. But it's called a typographic keepsake, casually assembled by Frank J. Thomas at the Ten Fingers Press for Friends of the Ormsby Public Library. But this is the title page, and it just gives examples of different typography he had done over the years. So I'll be bringing this little item.
Mm-hmm.
I'll put this back in here, maybe.
Sean, question. Is this the first time that you've brought that amount of material related to books on books to the book fair?
No. I brought some, this larger collection with the bookseller memoirs, and there's a lot of material on the history of the book. I brought that to the Seattle Fair in October, and it sold well.
Who's buying them? Younger, older people? Or mixed?
A mix. People who are curious and want, you know, especially it's great for people who are getting into the game of collecting. It is the story of those who bring things to market, but not only can booksellers learn from it, but the collectors can learn from as well.
How many book fairs do you do in an average year?
Well, I've been cutting back, and I'm probably at about 3 a year now.
Mm-hmm. And I'm sure most of our viewers who aren't in the business would have no idea what's involved. Do you have to pack up steamer trunks and ship them ahead with litter bearers, or what do you do when you go to an out-of-town show?
I should be busily cataloging. So if I have a book, I'm going to have a catalog entry. Now, I will offer these once I've gotten a list together, maybe 16 pages, 30, 40 items. I'll distribute those lists online through Facebook or email directly to customers on my mailing list or various listservs that are followed by collectors and dealers. But as I'm doing this, I'm setting aside ones that I want to take to a show. I'm piling them not into steamer boxes, but banker's boxes. I'll load those up, drive them up to, well, the shows I'm doing are the California Fair, this one here in Pasadena, and the Oakland one. Next year, the Antiquarian Booksellers Association of America Fair, the 51st California International Antiquarian Book Fair, will be in Pasadena in 2018. So for me, that's just a drive up the 110 freeway to Pasadena.
How big is the
booths? Oh, the booths are 10 by 10, I think.
How many tables?
I'll have two tables in Pasadena and a trophy case, which is a wall case. So it's, what, six feet tall, has shelves in it, display items in there. And then I'll bring four folding bookcases on two tables. And I'll put the bookcase up there and then load it with the books. And next day people will come in. We'll have fun with the public and other dealers for a couple days, talking about books, showing things off, writing invoices. And then Saturday evening, we'll pack things up and go home. And hopefully, I'll have some empty boxes. And I'll next week after that, I'll load up a few more boxes, and then be off to Oakland.
John Thorne. I'm an East Coast dealer, and I, as we're all aware, most of us here, we all did the St. Petersburg show, which I'll talk about in a little bit. But I also, and that is a traditional show, where Friday night, Saturday, all day Sunday, pack up Sunday and go home. And for Steve and myself, we fill up, Steve has a U-Haul, I fill up a Suburban, off we go, and I don't know how many books we take, but it's a lot. But the last couple of years, I've also been doing what's called a shadow or a satellite show, one in Boston, one in New York, which is basically a one-day show. If you do it right, you can actually get up there fly up the night before, set up that night, do the show the next day, and fly home. You know, it's a whole different situation. Obviously, you're flying. I'm taking much less books and all that. I kind of like the satellite shows because it's primary. A lot of it's, you know, dealers to dealers, and it's fun, it's quick, it's done, and away we go. Do you have any satellite shows that you even do? The California, the Pasadena, the Oakland shows have this, they call them satellite shadow shows here in the East Coast. I don't know what they call them in California. Do you have such a thing?
Well, the Pasadena show is the satellite show to the Oakland show. So the.
But they're not in the same city. Let's see, for us, the New York, my New York show is the same as the Boston AABA show. The Boston show is the same there. I grew up in Los Angeles, and trust me, Pasadena and Oakland ain't a one-hour drive.
Well, exactly.
They're different weekends, aren't they?
Yeah, exactly. So,
mine are the same weekend. That's the whole point. We get the same dealers.
Yeah, in New York and in New York and in Boston, the big ABAA show is in its venue, and then there's other shows nearby in the same city.
Right,
and
that's right.
A whole different collection of dealers. What happens a little bit, California is a little bit different because of the size. It's 450 miles roughly between the Bay Area and LA. So the shadow show will be in the LA, in the Southern California area this year. And then it's going to be a lot of the same dealers. So what happens, people will come from, international dealers will come, Europe, Japan, and do the shadow show in LA, and then they'll go up. So for one trip, they get to hit two markets. So that's
okay.
So the way we sometimes use satellite shows here, the terminology satellite shows, is that it's a satellite show of the big show in the same town, same day, not a week apart. Kind of a, maybe a bi-coastal differential in terminology. But to go back to the beginning of where we started this about book fairs, Lindsay, you asked the question about what the effort is, and while we've touched on it, let me just say this for nobody that's ever done a book fair. My booth is a little bigger. You can fit 6 8-foot tables in a U shape in my booth. It involves a couple of days to a week before the show, packing up over 1,000 to 1,200 books, putting them in boxes, sorting, pricing, so on, loading, unloading, selling, as John said, and then reboxing at the end. It's a labor of love, and it can be very intensive on miniature books or not.
Well, if I did only miniature books, maybe I could get them in 2 or 3 banker's boxes, but I probably am going to load up somewhere in the range of 8 to 12 banker's boxes. When I was doing the Sacramento fair, I would bring more. I would bring 16. I've done fairs where I've brought in the 20s, you know, 20 some odd banker's boxes. One thing that we do, a lot of LA dealers show at the Seattle Book Fair, which is in October. And what we do then is there's a dealer here in Southern California who will rent a vehicle, and about 12 of us last October brought our material to one location, and then a couple of dealers drove it up. I flew to Seattle. My material was there in the booth when I got there, but because we had so many dealers participating, they put me on a strict diet. I had to reduce the quantity of banker's boxes that I bought, and I actually enjoyed it. It was actually better to bring less. It was good. It was a good deal.
If we only knew which, depended on the size of the booth and inventory, which 80 to 120 or so books we're going to sell, it would be great. Before we go to talking with you about 1570, there's something that I have got to ask you to show if you can. A Jack the Ripper book that comes with its own heart. I once found a baby fetus in a jar in an estate sale that we were conducting for someone. But a human heart? Okay, I'm fascinated.
I will show you that. I just wanted to say one thing about what they're doing with the ABAA shows right now. We're trying to encourage people to bring or encourage collectors who are just starting out. So as part of a program, we're supposed to fill a shelf with books $100 and less or less. And then that's going to be featured in the book fair program. These dealers will have a shelf of inexpensive books. For me, that's not a problem. So we're going to be featuring, you can go to these fairs and you can look at a Charles Darwin First Origin of Species, $100,000. Newton's Principia, another $100,000-$150,000 book. Those books will be there, but there will be also more affordable books. I'm also going to be bringing a few early printed books. I have one here, which is on a gastronomy topic. The author is listed as Apicius, but that's really, it's a book of recipes, but it was put together in the 5th century AD. A monk went through there and mashed all these things together and then gave it the name of a Roman character. But that's really an anthology of recipes. I also have a book from the 18th century, which is the first time in a scholarly book. This is about shells and snails. And this particular plate here shows two snails copulating. But this German author was a theologian, was the first one to demonstrate snails have a sex life. Prior to that, they just thought that spontaneous combustion based on Aristotelian authority, well, they just kind of just appear. Well, he showed that they had a sex life.
This God, what a wonderful thing to have on your tombstone. I invented or I discovered the sex life of snails. I love it.
That's funny. And you're playing with the idea. He observed this, the design of shells fall in this geometrical pattern. So it's not to another century or two later that fractals became a big deal, but there's somebody in the 18th century playing with it. Yeah.
Sean, let me ask you one. Let me say two things. Show us the heart book if you have it accessible. And then we'd like to switch over a little bit to talk where Lindsay, who, if you don't know, Lindsay Thompson, Henry Bemis Books in North Carolina, is one of the co-hosts of the show, and he's also a retired attorney. And this Bill 1570 in California is something that we would like to hear, you being in California and Lindsay's knowledge of law. I think the audience would really be informed by that. The Hart book, though, I'm fascinated.
Okay, where's the camera now? All right. This book is not really a genuine miniature book, because a miniature book is a book that is 3 inches, no more 3 inches by 3 inches. And this particular book is a little bit more than 3 inches. But it's been beautifully, it's written by Sean Richards. And Sean is a bookbinder in Oklahoma. And he comes from a family of law enforcement personnel. And he's always been fascinated with Jack the Ripper. So he's gone out and collected facts. And so this is an alphabet book of facts about Jack the Ripper. And what he did was to illustrate the fact that the Jack the Ripper character or characters would often, he would mutilate the body, and he took body parts after the murders were committed. So in recognition of that, he's built up with paper mache around the box that the book will fit in, and he covered it with leather. So I guess this is would fall in the category of artist books that I'm doing at the fairs coming up in February.
Abby Schulman's in 102. Maybe she'll get it.
I am very curious to know who buys that book, John. If I may make a suggestion, be very careful to whom you sell it to.
Why is that?
Because he might be a serial killer or something looking for a new trophy.
Hi, my name's Hannibal Lecter.
I placed one of them at the biomedical library of at UCLA. So I don't think those guys are going to come after me.
Well, let's talk about who might then. And, you know, you having to fill out forms in California explaining what client sold you the book and violating their confidentiality and anonymity. Lindsay, I turn this over to you and John to start the ball rolling on the discussion of 1570, please.
Well, to start off, I want to ask John, I saw the other day in an article that the book fair this year has been providing some kind of best practices guide for all of you who are exhibiting on how to deal with 1570. Have you seen that, or have you come across it yet?
I believe the attorneys for the Antiquarian Booksellers Association of America has created such a document. I haven't read it in a while.
Okay.
I think it's only a page or two.
Okay.
I think what they've done is gone through the law and try to put it into a step-by-step way of thinking about how to conform with the law, which requires certificates of authenticity to go with any item that has been that is sold as signed and a collectible. And a collectible is defined by the law is something signed by personality, celebrity, author of book.
Well, maybe I could take a minute for our viewers and quickly summarize what AB 1570 is about, because this is a story that has really been below the radar in terms of general media. I've been surprised even how little press it has gotten within the book trade press. It's been very sporadic since last September. But this law popped up about a year ago. It was introduced by a California assemblywoman named Lingling Chang, who was running for a state Senate seat. And apparently she crossed paths with Mark Hamill of Star Wars fame, who finds that fake autographs of his are cutting into his income. And some sources I read say that of the $1 billion a year memorabilia market for autographed stuff, that as much as half of it in a given year can be fake. So obviously there was a significant problem there. What Assemblywoman Chang did was get up and offer a bill to amend a current law that would change the definition of what a collectible is from a sports item to pretty much anything under the sun that is signed. And so it can now cover books, it can cover a piece of art, it can cover anything, a sculpture with the artist's signature etched into the bottom, anything that has an artist's signature. And that all of a sudden popped up in September when Governor Brown signed this bill, which had slid through both houses of the California Assembly with nary a bit of notice. Now, when these bills get introduced, they get what's called a legislative history attached to them, and that begins with analysis by counsel for each house of the legislature. And if these are online, if you search around for them. And what was striking about this was that the legislative analysis given to all the members of the assembly was pretty much the same as Assemblywoman Chang's press release to get the whole ball started. Essentially, it said, this is a problem. It's cutting into genuine memorabilia sellers' income, and it's a good bill, and Mark Hamill's in favor of it, so pass it. So they did. The governor signed it, and then everybody started to read it. And what's remarkable about this bill is that in addition to redefining more broadly what is a collectible, it says that anyone who is a dealer who sells collectibles with signatures on them in or out of the state of California and who purports to have any kind of knowledge or skill in that field to be able to say, well, as far as I know, it is in fact Billy Graham's signature on this book, as opposed to somebody like a pawnbroker or a thrift shop who just piles stuff up and people buy it for pennies. Those people are covered by the law, as are people who do business by mail order, online, telephone, or TV. This is a remarkable expansion of the law. And then, as if that wasn't enough, as Mr. Howell mentioned, it requires certificates of authenticity piled up almost without number. If I, as an heir who want to sell you some autograph books my grandparents left me, come to see John Howell in his shop, I have to provide him with a certificate of authenticity, which he has to then keep for 7 years, as to who my grandparents got them from. Essentially, I've got to authenticate it, which I may not know how to do. And then if he turns around and sells it, he's got to authenticate it all over again. The bill goes so far as to tell him, as a dealer, what size the typeface on this certificate has to be, what it has to say, and you'll have a bonding requirement to back up your ability to represent that it is genuine. You have to keep all these records, as I mentioned, for 7 years, although on the flip side, there is no statute of limitations for suing under this bill. So problems that this presents are obviously that if you do a lot of what I do, which I call panning for gold at Salvation Army auctions, where I may buy a bin of 500 books for $50. And if I get seven or eight that are good, then I've made my money back and a nice profit. I don't necessarily know where those books came from. They've been aggregated from thousands and thousands that come in for donors. But yet, I can be sued if somebody gets that book from me in California, decides they don't want to keep it because they think the signature is dodgy. This applies to books for as little as $5 in value. And not only can somebody sue for that little an amount, they can. The sweetener is you can, if you win, you can get your costs and your attorney fees. Now, a lot of people have said, oddly enough, even people who ought to know better in the book trade, that, well, this doesn't apply to me. I don't do business in California. But because we live in a federation of 50 states, we have well-established law that says I can file a lawsuit in North Carolina, or more relevantly to our discussion, I can file in California and sue Lindsay Thompson in North Carolina for a book I bought from him. And all I got to do is get a process server in Charlotte to go give him the paperwork. So this is a bill that it was intended to deal with a largely California entertainment industry problem that has now become a national problem. And everybody's sitting back saying, well, either I can ignore it or I don't think it applies. Or in the case of eBay and Amazon, they're just passing the buck and saying, well, we expect our sellers to do the right thing and comply with the law. I suspect, and I'd be interested in knowing your thoughts, John, I suspect the test cases we'll see on this will be out of the art market because that's the kind of big dollar purchase that really warrants going and hiring a lawyer to try and see if this law is enforceable, given the multiple damages that are available. If you have a $100,000 painting and you could get 10 times value in damages, that's worth taking a flyer on. But not, I think, John, to me that the New York bar has been, their art law section has been getting involved in this.
Right. And there's no enforcement mechanism for AB 1570. It's only if a a customer is dissatisfied with the signature and it has to go to court to get redress for their complaint. So
may I interject a thought? Unless Lindsay, were you going to mention Easton?
Yeah, I was just coming to that. It seems like right now the legislature in California is back in session. They missed, as I understand it, a deadline for repealing it within 2 weeks of when it went into effect. So now they have to go through the whole process of enacting new legislation to amend it. In the meantime, people are starting to get serious about it, and Easton Press, several of whose books John showed us just now, is now advertising in its promos that it will not ship to California. I think it's beginning to bite that this may be a problem. And John kindly provided me with an analysis the California Assembly Legislative Council did that basically just threw their hands up and said, well, it may apply and it may not.
Exactly.
You booksellers are the one who get to find out. Now, for her part, Assemblywoman Chang, who did not get her sentence with this feel-good bill in November, put a letter out saying, well, I didn't mean it to include booksellers, but she didn't get even that right because there is a process for registering your legislative intent as part of the record of a bill. And Mark Kuritz, the Churchill bookseller from California that Stephen had on his radio show in November, explained that to us in some detail. And she didn't get that done in a timely way. So my guess is that at this point, we're all just going to have to sit back and hope for the best. For my part, have put a notice up on my site that I'm not shipping to California till this is corrected. Do you have a sense, John, of what's going on in the assembly?
We have a little good news that came through yesterday. There is a new assembly bill. It's bill number 228. And it was introduced by assembly members Gloria and Chu January 26, 2017. And it's an act to amend section 1739.7 of the Civil Code, which was recently amended by 1570. But what it does, what it basically does is it rewords section 1570 to address some of the issues we have regarding the certificate of authenticity and who is a dealer. And it's going to be very helpful. There is on change.org a petition to amend AB 1570. And if you Google California AB 1570, petition or change.org, you can sign that petition. And I would encourage consumers to do so. I mean, already California consumers are being hurt. There's people like Easton Press, people like Lindsay, who are not going to ship to California customers. There's dealers who are not going to come to the California fairs because they don't want to be put at risk by that law. So you can also, I suppose you could Google California Assembly Bill number 228 and find the full text of the law. In particular, if you're a California dealer, you should read AB 1570, you should read the new law to amend it. But we don't anticipate the law to amend it. It has to go through the entire legislative process, and we don't expect that to be completed until about June or July. But you can familiarize yourself with it and sign the petition because it will still be helpful for the petition on change.org. We have over 1,600 signatures there. The more we get, the better.
I will add the petition is up on this website for the Rare Book Cafe, and the petition is up on Books on the Bookshelf, and will be there into perpetuity. Listen, if you can, make a closing statement on this end of it. And John, you are always welcome back on the show, and we will talk about this more. But I am going to, after you guys, I'm going to introduce another segment of the show.
Well, I think we've run a bit long here, so that's really all I need to cover, Stephen. I'm sure we'll be continuing to follow this and talk about it as the year rolls on.
Well, I am going to hand my headset off to my wife, and Thorne will take over, and Edie will be in the chair shortly talking to you about the wonderful world of miniature books.
All righty. Thank you, Steve. Well, although we can't quite give it a 50 years, I wanted to mention the fact that the 36th anniversary of the Florida Antiquarian Book Fair is coming up this April 21st through the 23rd. It's at the St. Petersburg Coliseum. It's I'd like to bring to people's attention that we've had about a 3 or 4 week change of our traditional date this year. We had some issues with the New York Book Fair, as a lot of other people in the world have had. So for this year, it's going to be towards the end of April, and we will probably be going back to late February or early March in future years. But for this year, it's the 21st, 23rd. We have about 120 dealers signed up, and I believe it is now the third or fourth largest in terms of member count and a dealer count show after New York, California. I believe we're number three, and then Boston comes in at number four. So great deal of fun. And here is Edie. What do you have to show us, young Edie?
Hi, how are you, everybody?
Hi.
Hi, Edie.
Listen, I took a look at myself after I had my new eye done by Dr. Poole. And so I've got a new do, and I've got a new me. And I am absolutely thrilled with that. When I had spoken this week to James Brogan from the Microbibliophile, because he's going to be doing a story on Stephen and I, how we met, et cetera, et cetera. And he is an expert on the Kingston Press, or at least he told me that he really specializes in it. And so first I'm going to regress to what I had done last week, just for a little bit, with my books, The Three Presidentials. And I have variants of two of them. I have a variant of the Coolidge, and I have a variant of the Washington. And he had told me that there are three variants of those two. The Lincoln, there was only one. So I stand corrected, but I'm delighted that I have two. And now I can go ahead and I can be looking out the third one. The next thing that I have that I want to show you is that Karen Nyman, who is one of the people that I love, her book of the month club, book of the week, the specialty, is a ultra micro mini in little case of a magnifier. I put in pennies so you could see the different sizes. And there are seven variants of the Lord's Prayer in different languages in that micro mini. And she is selling it this week for $28 and $3 for shipping and handling. So you can always reach Karen Nyman on her website, which is www.karennymanminiaturebooks.com. And I did want to mention that. Her phone number is 619-26-4441. And you have until tomorrow to be able to order that little miniature book. The next thing that I wanted to tell you is that the miniature book. First of all, many, many people will say a miniature book is 3 inches or smaller, and that's a macro mini. However, The Library of Congress has books that are 4 inches tall. Call them miniature books also. And so consequently, I wanted to mention that. 2 to 3 inches high is a mini. 1 to 2 inches high is a micro mini. An inch or less is an ultra micro mini. Now, John, I understand that you're going to be taking a miniature book to the book fair in California.
Quite a few. Yes.
What?
Quite a few, yes.
Quite a few. What would you define a miniature book as, John?
3 inches or less.
Inches or less.
Yeah, height or width.
Oh, yes, in all directions. Okay. So the Library of Congress, I guess, is wrong. Ha ha ha.
Well, I guess I'll have to sell them Sean Richards' Jack the Ripper Bloody Alphabet.
Oh, okay. There you go. There you go. It's like I always say, buy what you like. If you buy what you like and you enjoy them and you like to hold them and fondle them and look at them, then that's great. The other thing that I wanted to mention today is magnifying glasses. Now, this one happens to be a frog. When we go out on the hunt, whenever I see a magnifying glass, I'll always pick it up. And I have frogs, I have turtles, I have some that I can wear around my neck. I have different things like that, and I thoroughly, thoroughly, thoroughly enjoy them all. The next thing that I wanted to talk about is there is a press called Jack R. Levien, L-E-V-I-E-N, Reader Press, from 1970 to 1972. He was in Holland. From 1967 to 1969, he was in New York City. And since I have now begun to about trying to get my collection collated and cataloged, I have some of his little books. This one is called Brigitte, and it is a micro mini. They were all done in 1970 in Holland. And as I was looking at my collection, I found out that I had a little collection of his books. This one is called Have a Cigarette. Okay. This one is called Business Worries. This one is Enjoy Life, and you have a little character there enjoying life. This one is Noah's Ark. This one is A Tribute to Sin, S-I-G. And the last one is John Andrew Levien's Family Quotations. Now, these are fun. When I have these, I will sit with a magnifying glass and I will actually look through the pages, which probably diminishes some of what they have. Now, I'm going to give this back to you, Lindsay. They are doing some work in the apartment under me, and consequently, Stephen is going down to tell them to stop working. So I will stay on. Lindsay, go ahead. Or is it to Thorne?
Okay, I think it'd be good if I take over, and maybe, Edie, if you could hit the mute the microphone button so we don't get to hear the construction talk, if you could possibly do so. But I want to talk for a couple of minutes at any rate about something that was a course I took recently at the University of Virginia Rare Book School called Provenance. It kind of somewhat ties into what Lindsay and John were speaking about the signatures. provenance is pretty much who owned the book before you. If you, right. A lot of times you'll see books at auctions or you'll see them in a museum, and it's a list of names before. I just happened to come back yesterday from New York City. Morgan Library there is a fantastic library. Most of us know of it. And they, as other people do, have a copy of the Gutenberg Bible. Well, the Gutenberg Bible was obviously done in the 15th century, 1450, I think it was. And it was done by Mr. Gutenberg. There's some question about that. But then it went on to various owners. The one that's the Morgan, they seem to have had lost for a couple hundred years. And then apparently it was found by a Russian diplomat named Kamensky, who then sold it to Korek, who was a very famous book dealer.
I'm sorry for that noise. As soon as we're done, I'm calling code enforcement. I apologize. Look, guys. And then after...
Steven, turn off your microphone.
I'll be back in a minute. I'm sorry.
And then after Mr. Irwin bought it, it was bought by the Morgan Library. So when you go and look at the provenance of that, it's called the Kramas Corus Irwin Morgan book. But not all of us have books that are that famous. But what I like to be doing for some of my books, I've seen book plates. You will see simple signatures from the library of Thorne Donnelley. Some of those are good for it. I've been fascinated by a lot of what's called armorial plates, which are basically the royal plates of British families. I took a test on one of them last year to learn about it, because one of the books I had, and I have to read you the description of the book that I had purchased. In quarters 1 and 4, a chevron between 3 pelican heads erased, voning themselves a crescent for difference. In quarter 2, a fess between 3 crosslets fitchy, and quarter 3, a fess between 6 scallops. Now that is actually in English, and I read it reasonably correctly. What it really told me is that that book had belonged to a family of a guy by the name of Sir James Mallory. And it was his book plate with his family emblem in it. There is a department in London all about heraldry that you literally can take this stuff ad nauseum. But anyway, it looks like Steve is back here. And I think it's time that Steve would like to give a talk here. Steve, I'll hand it back to you. We'll talk about provenance some other time.
Yeah, and I mean, we've got about 2 minutes. So I guess, you know, what I will do is just say first, I apologize for my downstairs condominium, but that's why code enforcement's going to be called in a couple of minutes. We had to deal with these people, never on Saturday. So what I'd like to talk about for about a minute and a half is just something that I think everybody knows what the limited editions club is, but as I've talked to dealers over the years, what I have found out is that most people don't know this little portion of the story. We all know that LEC came from Macy's and that he produced beautiful limited edition books, but why did he do it? The short version of the story is that during Macy, as we all know, was a very egotistical guy. During the period that he had his rare book section and his public book section, as into the trade, publishers came out with limited editions quite a bit in the 20s and 30s. In order for Macy to get, say, 10 copies of the limited edition, the publishers would make him buy, whether they had the second, the third, the fourth, the ninth of the first edition, he would have to buy X number of copies of the trade edition in order to get limited editions for his better clients. Basically, Macy, being the kind of guy he said, listen, you guys, I'm making a bigger, better book. I'm going to bring in the best artists and illustrators. I'm going to finally bind them, and I'm going to limit them to 1,500 and 2,000 copies, and you're not going to be able to do this to me anymore. So while he came out with a beautiful club, I tell you that's the reason why. And now I would just like to say it's been a pleasure. John Howell, thank you for being with us today. Lindsay Thorne, Alan backstage, thank you. The audience out there, remember, you can see the show, tell your friends about it. at floridabookfair.blogspot.com, April 21st to 23rd. We hope to see you all at the Florida Antiquarian Book Fair in St. Peter's at Agatha Coliseum. And we will be back here next week with the Rare Book Cafe, same time, same station. And don't forget to join me before the show starts from 12 to 2 for Books on the Bookshelf on WDBFradio.com. We'll see you all next week. Find some great books. Ciao for now.